أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا إنه من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين ولا إله إلا الله إلهنا وإله الأولين والآخرين وقيوم السماوات والأرضين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه وسلم الله تبارك وتعالى رحمة للعالمين وإماما للمتقين وحجة علينا نحن الخلائق أجمعين فأخرجنا به من ظلمات الكفر إلى نور الإيمان بالله رب العالمين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد إخوة الإسلام هذان مشهدان مر علي الأسابيع الماضية وأرى أنه من الأهمية بمكان أن تكون هذه الأمور واضحة أمامنا جميعا لأنها تتعلق بالدين والدين هو الحياة الدين في حياتنا هو حياتنا enough أمور كثيرة تتعرض لدينك وأنت ربما تشارك فيها تشكك وتضحد وتتبع أناسا أرادوا الهدم لدينك وأنت لا تدري أمور كثيرة نتعرض لها نحن المسلمين في بلادنا بلاد الإسلام ونراها بأعيننا ولا نحرك ساكنا لأنهم قدموها لنا في إطار تجديد هذا الدين الذي لا أنا ولا أنت ولا هم لا لنا الاستطاعة أصلاً أن نجدد أو أن نضيف ما أكده ووضحه الله سبحانه وتعالى من خلال نبيه محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. مشهدان. So my dear brothers and listening sisters, two things. You can say, you can call them two scenes. Happened or that I personally witnessed the last few weeks. One in Egypt, because I was there, yani visiting my family in my country that I love, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect it, as I ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect all the Muslim countries all over the world. The second one was last week. Once I came, I got that email from one of the brothers or the boys of Edmonton complaining about something, and then when I looked at both, I found them leaning to one thing. It's your deen. المشهد الأول ما رأيت بنفسي أو شاهدت بعيني من هجوم متعمد على الدين من خلال الهجوم على المؤسسات الدينية التي جعلها الله ساترا وحماية لهذا الدين. ومن المؤلم أن ترى أن الدين يهاجم في أرضه وفي وطنه وفي بلده وبين أهله. فإن هوجم الدين، إن هوجم الإسلام في بلد غير مسلم فهذا مقبول، لكن أن يهاجم الإسلام في بلد الإسلام وأن يكون المسلمون هم من يهاجمونه، إذن نحن في خطر. ليس الدين في خطر، إنما أنت في خطر. دعونا نعمل، هذه هي الدعوات أو الدعايات التي يدعون بها. أولا دعونا سويا نجدد الخطاب الديني، فهو في حاجة إلى تجديد. الأمر الثاني، لابد لنا من وقفة مع هذه المؤسسة التي تحمي الدين لأكثر من 1000 عام. الأزهر فهو منبع الإرهاب ومنبع العنف، وهو الذي يحض على العنف، وللأسف أنت تقرأ ذلك. نعم نعم، نحن في حاجة إلى ذلك. هذا الشيخ أنا لا أحبه، هذا الرجل أنا لا أريده، أنا أريد هذا القائد، هذا القائد الذي أرسله الله لي ليخرجني من هذه السيطرة الدينية، من هؤلاء القوم الذين يسيطرون علي، إلى حياة بها أريحية، حياة بها حرية، حياة أرتكب فيها ما أشاء وما أريد دون وازع، دون رادع من دين أو من مجتمع. So the first scene, something that I witnessed and I lived with it, few weeks, where you see Islam or religion is being attacked in the country of Islam. Yahi, go and read. I'm just taking Egypt as an example, by the way. This is happening everywhere and in every Muslim country nowadays. We Muslims, so-called Muslims, we attack Islam. We attack our sources. We attack our texts. He doesn't like this hadith. She doesn't like this ayah. She's leading the Muslims in prayer. He is innovating this. You know what? We don't want a Muslim or Islamic country. We don't want Islamic Sharia. We don't want. You are saying that. And you're watching the TV and yes. That's right. Go and live over there. See what's happening when the people are away from Islam. Go. Wallahi, last week I was going to Jumu'ah and I was late. And then the masjid is next to the cafe or the qahwa, whatever it is. And I looked at the masjid. Yani if you see a Muslim brother living next door or in this neighborhood and he doesn't come to pray on Friday, and you are in Canada in a Muslim country, yani you're gonna be like surprised. How come he doesn't pray with us? He doesn't come to the masjid. Go to your country, and I'm not naming Egypt only. Go to your country today and see this time of the week, the Jumu'ah, the masjid is next to the shop or the market or whatever it is. And look at the people. Way more than 20 to 50% or around 20 to 50% of the people are outside, and they don't care, by the way. They're not praying. They're not going to pray. And the Jumu'ah is on. And the people are praying Jumu'ah. Why? Because we're listening to these people. We watch TV, and I know, even if I want to talk to only Egyptian over here in this hall, in this masjid, I know that you go home in the evening and you follow WhatsApp or whatever, Facebook, or you go to the TV and you watch them. Yes, they're right. We had to get rid of those people. Those people wanted to make our life very strict and very hard. Let's get rid of them. They don't want to get rid of those people. Those people were just a barrier between them and destroying your religion. Now they're saying, you know what? Al-Azhar is the source of violence. No, it's not. No, we spent over 15 years in Al-Azhar. We didn't get anything about violence. They never taught anything, because this is what's in the Quran. That's what we teach non-Muslims over here. When we talk about Islam, it's not this. It's them over here or over there, anywhere in the world, understanding that the easy way to destroy you and your religion is through you. When you say, you know what, I don't like this, because you're looking for a free and easy life. ولذلك أنا أرى ذلك المشهد تماما يعني that's happening, as I said, everywhere, in every Muslim country. The people of religion have to, you know, stay away from our law. I want to do everything. I don't want somebody coming to me and say that this is wrong, or this is haram, or this is illegal. I want to do whatever I want. So the religion is there to discipline you. And if there is no religion, I will do whatever I want. And when I say religion, by the way, and I'm not going to be compromising anything. When I say religion, I mean Islam. إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. When I saw this, I remember the situation of Prophet Yusuf عليه السلام. لأنهم حينما يذكروك بذلك ما قالوش دعونا نتخلص من الخطاب الديني. قالوا دعونا نجدد الخطاب الديني. Let's renew the religious discourse. They didn't say let's destroy it. Yeah, in a nice way, he's getting to your roots, he's getting to your sources, he's getting to your religion to destroy it. Throw a nice word. But go back with me to the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala razaqa Sayyidina Yaqub 12 ولد منهم سيدنا يوسف عليه السلام. أحب يوسف أحب بنيامين لأنهما كانا أصغر إخوتهم. So Allah سبحانه وتعالى gave سيدنا يعقوب the father of سيدنا يوسف 12 children. But he used to love Prophet Yusuf and Prophet and Benjamin way more than others for a simple reason. A very simple reason, because they were young, that's it. Not because he was not fair to his kids, but that's human nature. But look what happened. انظر معي إلى ما حدث. يتحدثون سويا. الله سبحانه وتعالى يقول لقد كان في يوسف وإخوته آيات للسائلين. أنا جاي لك للدين. أنت بتقول إيه علاقة قصة سيدنا يوسف بالدين يا شيخ؟ أنت بتقول لي الدين والحياة؟ إيه العلاقة؟ هقول لك إيه العلاقة. لقد كان there was a great sign for those who ask in the story of Prophet Yusuf عليه السلام and his brothers. إذ قالوا جاءوا وقالوا هذا الرجل رجل الدين هذا الرجل الذي يمثل الفضيلة هذا الرجل وهذه المؤسسة التي تمثل الحجاب بينك وبين الرذيلة وبين الحرام أحب إلى أبينا منا ونحن عصبة إن أبانا لفي ضلال مبين. هما دي سيدة. You know, Abraham, Yusuf and Benjamin are closer, are more beloved to our father than us.
While we are clan, we're strong. We have the media. We have the power. We have the sword. We have the weapon. We have the money. We have everything. How can we leave the people, the public, to the people of religion? No, they have to stay away. أبعدوهم أخرجوهم من المشهد بطريقة أو بأخرى. أخرجوا الدين من المشهد. هذا ما يريدون. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى ونحن عصبة. We have the power. إن أبانا لفي ضلال مبين. He is our father. He is in a great error. What should we do? اقتلوا يوسف أو اطرحوه أرضا يخلو لكم وجه أبيكم وتكونوا. خلينا أقف هنا. Kill him. Put him away. Send him away. Force him to travel to another country. Force him to go to Turkey. Force him to go to America. We don't need those people. We don't need the religion. We don't need the religious people. Those people have influence, I'm telling you. I'm not talking about myself, but alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Through the religion, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me the power to have influence on some people, and they listen. Because you are, as I will explain, religious by fitrah. You are religious. You love religion. I will prove you that you love religion. However, you don't like this guy, a religious person, or a religious leader, or a religious group, but you are a religious person at the end of the day. They said that, kill him, send him away, يَخْلُ لَكُمْ وَجْهُ أَبِيكُمْ. Now, after they are away from the picture, now you have the people. You send them this piece of whatever newspaper, you get them this TV show, whatever it is, you control the people. You will be controlling them easily. You tell them that those religious people are terrorists, they will listen to you. They will believe you because they are not there. They are not there. Say whatever you want. But the problem is, but don't forget, you are a good person. وَتَكُونُ مِن بَعْدِهِ. After that, you will be a good people. How come, yeah? How come when you know that those people, when they take over or they are threatening and attacking your religion, they used illegal ways. They are using illegal ways to attack your religion, your Islam, and you're there and you're watching and you're happy. And now they're trying to convince you that you're good and they're good and those are evil. Wallahi abadan, ya akhi, الدين هو الفطرة. والله أبدا يا أخي الدين هو الحياة. بغير الدين لن ننجح أبدا. بغير الدين لن نعيش أبدا. هكذا أراد الله. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول في الحديث الصحيح الذي رواه الإمام البخاري ومسلم في صحيحيهما عن سيدنا أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال صلى الله عليه وسلم كل مولود أو كل غلام يولد على الفطرة وأبواه يعودانه أو ينصرانه أو يمجسانه. أنت ولدت مسلمة وهو ولد مسلمة وأنت كأب وأنا سآتي إلى هذه النقطة لأنها تتعلق بالمشهد الآخر الثاني الذي معي في الخطبة. دورك أن تجعل ابنك مسلما. أول عياذ بالله أن تتخلى عن دورك وتراه أمامك غير مسلم فأنت مسؤول أمام الله. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said clearly that to ensure and to confirm the fact that the religion is the most important thing in your life. That you're born as a religious person. You're born as a Muslim. He said that clearly in the authentic hadith. Every baby is born as our own fitrah. Fitrah, the natural instinct of being Muslim. As a Muslim. And that's the role of the father and the mother to make their kids, you know, if they want to make them, hatta sometimes when I have the brothers coming to me and he's in love with a non-Muslim girl, I point this point, I highlight this point too much with them. Be careful. Because you don't know what's going to happen after. Will you have a non-Muslim wife raising your kids that you want them to be Muslims? يعني, and I'm not trying to be offensive to our sisters, but we still have problems with some sisters understanding the importance of raising the kids the Islamic way. What about if a non-Muslim sister, a non-Muslim lady raising your kids and you're always outside and busy with your work? يعني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم made it clear, it's both of you making them this way or that way, Muslims or non-Muslims. Number one, يبقى الدين هو الحياة, الدين هو الفطرة, الدين هو هذا الوحي. هما ليه يريدون إبعادك عن الدين وإبعاد الدين عنك؟ Why do you think that those people want you to be away from your religion, from the straight path? Because it's simply, that's what tells you this is wrong and this is right. That's what tells you this is haram and this is halal. That's what tells you that, akhi, this is harmful to the community. That's what tells you, you know what? I was reading today about, and hatta the atheist person, when he is in trouble, he say, oh God, right or wrong? Oh Jesus. Yeah, they say Isa, Isa is not God for us, but he thinks that he is God for some other people. Yeah, that's the reality. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يقول في سورة الروم, وَإِذَا مَسَّ النَّاسَ ضُرٌ دَعَوْا رَبَّهُمْ مُنِيبِينَ إِلَيْهِ ثُمَّ إِذَا هو دي مشكلتنا. مشكلتنا يا أخي إن أنت سبحانه وتعالى عارف رب العالمين وتعرف الدين وكل حاجة, ولكن إذا الحياة سهلة وسلسة أنت العملية تمام ومش محتاج الدين, وإذا صعبت شوية بترجع لرب العالمين, تلاقي في الجامع وعندك مذاكرة عندك امتحان, يبقى الواحد بيجري بيرجع إلى الله عز وجل. الله سبحانه وتعالى يقول وإذا مس الإنسان, so look at the meaning of the understanding of the power, the overpower, that everybody understand this, even somebody who doesn't have a religion, at a certain time of hardship, of calamity, they go back to the Creator, to the power that controls everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Rum, when the people, when calamity hits people, دَعَوْا رَبَّهُمْ مُنِيبِينَ, they go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala making dua. ثُمَّ إِذَا أَذَاقَهُمْ مِنْهُ رَحْمَةً, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taste or make them taste a mercy from Him, إِذَا فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ بِرَبِّهِمْ يُشْرِكُونَ. يَا خَوَ اللَّهِ الْعَظِيمِ, some people of them, or some of them, they go and associate others and worship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because their life is easy. They're taking it easy. يَا خِي وَاللَّهِ, without the religion we cannot survive. Without this barrier between you and the haram, you will never be able to continue. You will be doing everything haram and everything wrong, and there is no reason to stop. There is nothing. Why don't you do this and you do that? Because there is limit to control the whole community. ولذلك الله سبحانه وتعالى, and I'm trying to look at the time, I'm just back after 6 weeks, and I want to take my time for the last 6 weeks, for the khutbah today, if you don't mind. الله سبحانه وتعالى يقول أيضا, وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِنَ الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ. This is the religion. It tells you, you know what, go and do this, because there is a reward waiting for you. And don't do that, because there is a punishment waiting for you. Here is a self-discipline. You don't need that law. You don't need the law, the man-made law, to control your life, because you know that my religion tells me to do that or not to do that. وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِنَ الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٍ. يا أخي, think with me. Whoever does good, righteous, good deed, man or woman, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٍ. It's not somebody who's atheist, who doesn't believe in God, or associate others in worship with God, and he does good. This is not the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. He wants one believes in the one first. توحيد وهو مؤمن. يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى فلنحيينه حياته, you will have the best life over here, ولنجزينهم أجرهم بأحسن ما كانوا يعملون. You will get better than what you put. This is the religion, and this is why that's why they want you to be away from your religion. That's the first scene, the first thing that I wanted to discuss. Look at the second one. And here is, yani it's very relative. Open your eyes and open your heart with me if you have kids. If you don't have kids, open your eyes and heart too, because inshallah you'll have kids. It might happen with you. This boy emailed me, yani, I can read the email to you if you want, but I'm gonna just summarize it. Sheikh, I'm so worried. أشعر بكثير من القلق مما يا أخي لما يحدث مع بعض أصدقائي في المرحلة أو المراحل الأولى من الجامعة. ماذا يحدث معهم يا أخي؟ أنا عارف النبي ما يقول لي. قال تربوا في بيئة مسلمة وبعضهم حفظ القرآن، ولكن ما يحدث معهم الآن، وأنت مش جاي هنا تتفسح. You're not here just to enjoy your life and to leave your kids only for activities the whole day, schools and activities. You're not here for that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you about those kids. If one of them goes astray, it's your responsibility. فقال بعضهم تربى تربية إسلامية ثم الآن الكثير منهم يشكك في الدين. خلاص مش عاجبه موضوع الدين ده خالص. يقولون بعضهم يؤمن بنظرية التطور، وبعضهم يعتبر بأن الإسلام دين يدعو إلى الرجعية والتخلف، ولا يريدون تطبيق تعاليم الإسلام. أعمل إيه معاهم يا شيخ؟ أنا ممكن أسأل السؤال وأمشي. ممكن أسأل لك أنت السؤال وتقعد تفكر. لو ابنك جالك وقال لك المعلومة دي تعمل إيه معاه؟ لو ابنك جالك هقول لك أنا إيه مشكلتك؟ هتبقى إيه؟ إن أنت ابنك عنده 17 18 سنة وعمرك ما اتكلمت معاه في الدين وما تحكش عن نفسك. عمرك بعته كده وقلت له خلق الإنسان كيف بدأ؟ عمرك بعته معاه فهمته يعني إيه؟ خليفة في الأرض. عمرك ما قعدت معاه واتكلمت معاه عن التكليف. عمرك ما اتكلمت معاه عن نظرية الثواب والعقاب، عن المسؤولية، عن تصرفاته أمام الناس وأمام الله. عمرك ما عملت كده، فعشان كده هتبقى عاجز ومش هتقدر تعالج المشكلة معاه وهيضيع من إيدك. So the second scene or the thing or note that happened is one of the brothers, boys, يعني that I know him very well. He emailed me expressing his worry. Sheikh, I'm so worried. What happened? Some of my friends, they used to be, or they were raised in a religious environment. Some of them, they memorized parts, big part of the Quran. But what happened now with them is some of them are doubting the religion. Doubting their religion, Islam. They're doubting they're accusing Islam that Islam is the religion of, يعني, a religion does not call for knowledge or acquiring knowledge. A religion that, you know what, they're close to accept the Darwin theory of evolution. Yes, because what can we do with them? You as a father, when you listen to this, don't say, you know what, no, not my son. My son is, alhamdulillah, is amazing. I'm telling you, maybe your son memorized three, four surahs. Those kids, they used to memorize some, a great part of the Quran. Some of them, they memorized the whole Quran, which is a problem that we have. I'm telling you. And maybe I'm one of the people who does the same mistake. I want my son to memorize the Quran. How many surahs that he understand or know? I don't care. Or some people, I want my son to read or to finish the whole Quran with the Shaykh. And we do a big walima and big party, and we invite يعني, Pakistan and India and Bangladesh and Egypt. Everybody comes to the walima or the party. My son finished reading the whole Quran. Alhamdulillah, great. Great thing, I'm with you. But does he know what he read? Does he know? Does he stop at a certain ayah and you discuss it with him? Did you talk to him about his job on earth? Did you talk to him about the consequences of a crime? The consequences of a mistake in our religion? If he's talking about or understanding or trying to accept the theory of evolution, then you talk to him and tell him, you know what? What about if you kill somebody? What's the sin of this person? And who's going to give him his right? If he understands that everything happened by accident and we just die. Yahi, no. Yahi, everything in the religion, everything in Islam, if they're doubting facts and principles of Islam, you have to be there. And you have to know yourself that it's a very important thing to talk about it. It's your religion, akhi. It's your life. You have to be there. You have to understand that, no, I'm not going to go to my son and tell him, son, this is haram, you're going to be in the fire. He will never listen to you. Don't think that when you tell him, you know what, if you think this way, you will be in the hellfire. He will tell you, I don't care about you or the hellfire. You have to sit with him. You have to get it from him and talk to him and explain the religion to him. It's his light upon you. I'm telling you, I'm not happy with their and the way that they're thinking, but at the end of the day, it's our mistake. We don't talk to them. We don't explain things to them. We left them to the other influences, and then they got it and they read about it, and now they're talking about this lady who led, and a part of the things that he mentioned, this lady who led the salat, led the congregation in the salat. Yahi, wallahi, very simple to answer. In the open house, somebody came to me and said that, you know, Sheikh, I'm sorry, but I have a very, very simple question. Why the woman cannot be an imam? Very simple, Yahi. Imam prays 5 times a day, or Muslims, man prays 5 times a day, every single day of his life. Enough, that's the answer. And he, one of the conditions of the prayer, of the validity of the prayer, that he has to be clean. And there's something with the woman that cannot be taken out for a few days a month. She cannot leave the salah. Very simple. And many things that you can say, and this is not hadith, I didn't say hadith now. I use the analogy with them, and you have to do that. And you have to open your heart. Akhi, think about your religion. Think about that you're responsible for your religion in this country. The country that protects you and protects your religion. I'm telling you, wallahi, here I can say as much as I want. I didn't give a khutbah in Egypt, alhamdulillah. Otherwise you didn't see me here. So this is the reality. You are, alhamdulillah, Allah blessed you. Allah blesses everybody here. That alhamdulillah, in this hard time that the Muslim Ummah goes through, you are in a place that you can practice your religion easily. My son has his school today. They have a field trip, a music field trip, whatever it is. I don't know. I looked at the paper and usually he doesn't go. I'm not strict, but I don't like him to be around. And the teacher was, wallahi, yesterday, she was apologizing. I'm sorry that I sent the announcement home because I know that he's not allowed to go. Wallahi al-Azim, she apologized to me yesterday. In a country, it's a non-Muslim country. And I'm telling you, I just came back. People don't pray. And they're asking about their life and stuff. You make it tough. You make it tough in yourself because you took the religion away. And you want religion to be away from your road. I want to do whatever I want. Your life will be tough. Not because I said it. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it in Surah Taha. He said, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِ فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. Go and read the meaning of this word. If you're away and you don't like to live or to live Islam, فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. Your life will be tough, will be harsh. You will be following the dollar until you die. You got the house, you need the car. You got the car, you need the business. You got this, you need that, because you're following something else. Islam is not in the picture. So out of these two things that everybody witnesses, or most of us witness is the importance, how comes the importance of the religion of your life, or in your life. Live Islam and make Islam as your lifestyle. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it easy on you. أَقُلُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ أَوْلُ اللَّهَ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى وَأَنْتُمْ مُوقِنُونَ.
الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباد الله المصطفى أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم بعد some people are thinking now that the sheikh will be taken 3-4 hours and inshallah we're finishing soon the as we heard in the announcement before the salah I know يعني last week we had our brother Sheikh Ahmed Qandil from Montreal and he was like trying to raise money for their masjid over there and today we have our brothers from Rindir and next week and the week after and the week after and the week after until the Ramadan is done you would have me talking about the importance of supporting your own masjid but and I usually say the easy thing to raise money for is the masjid وَإِنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَدْعُوا مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا Because the masjid is the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guarantees that He will maintain the masjid. You are a reason. I am a reason. That's it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses us to take ajr, reward, to be part of a great project like the masjid. The brothers from Rindir, يعني, as you guys know, Rindir is like the central Alberta, and it's this masjid serves around like 100 kilometers area and the brothers mashallah the community is getting is growing over there and they need to expand to go to a bigger place they bought the land they have a deadline this month they have to come up with $150,000 to complete the $600,000 the price of the land that they already bought for the masjid you know you don't need to think too much about it Just think about that the Prophet said, "Man bana lillahi masjida, bana Allahu lahu baytan fil jannah." Whoever built a masjid for the sake of Allah, participated in building a masjid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build him a house in the Jannah. The Prophet said that these are one of the things that it will stay for you until the day of judgment when you leave going eternity. Sadaqa jariya, idha mat ibn Adam, inqata 'amaluhu illa min thalath, sadaqa jariya aw 'ilmun yuntafa'u bih. أو ولد صالح يدعو له أسأل الله عز وجل أن يجعلنا جميعا من الذين يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا كفر عنا سيئاتنا توفنا مع الأبرار ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا لا تدع لنا في هذا اليوم العظيم ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا ميتا إلا رحمته ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا لك فيها رضا ولنا فيها صلاح إلا قضيتها ويسرتها لنا رب العالمين وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كما كانت